There are few true auteurs in the gaming industry, and there is no other like Hideo Kojima. Despite entering the business with little knowledge of how development actually worked, Kojima's ideas and work ethic set him apart from his peers, allowing him to become one of the industry's most revered developers. This is how a poor kid with dreams of making movies would become one of the most celebrated game developers of all time. This is Hideo Kojima. Hideo Kojima was born the youngest of three children on August 24, 1963 in Setagaya, Tokyo. His family was somewhat wealthy and moved often when he was young, first to Osaka when he was just 4 years old. From there, his family would move to a small city named Shirasaki, and then to Kawanashi-Higayo in the Kansai region. From an early age, Kojima loved several forms of art, particularly film. This love for movies was instilled by his parents, who were avid fans of Western, horror, and European cinema. It was a tradition in the household to stay up every night and watch a movie together. Kojima wasn't even allowed to go to sleep before the film ended. When he turned 10, Hideo's parents encouraged him to watch movies in theaters on his own, on the condition that he'd return with the film's brochure and discuss its themes and direction. Kojima frequently returned home from school before his parents finished work, and used television to escape his loneliness, watching anime, cooking shows, wildlife documentaries, and a variety of Western shows to pass the time. Using art to escape his isolation is a practice that has followed Kojima to this day. He's since said that when he travels, the first thing he does in his hotel is turn on the TV to deal with his feelings of loneliness. Watching films and television so frequently led Hideo to make his own art, inspiring dreams of becoming an illustrator or filmmaker. He eventually teamed up with a friend who owned an 8mm camera and started filming his own home movies. In high school, Kojima convinced his friends to collaborate on a zombie movie for their school's culture festival. Once completed, they attempted to sell tickets for the movie to attendees, hoping to raise funds to buy movies. The friends only managed to sell a few tickets by the end of the festival, not even enough to afford a single film. Unfortunately, Kojima would know tragedy early in his life, as his father passed away when Hideo was just 13 years old. Kojima himself also had frequent near-death experiences, being attacked by a dog, nearly drowning in a river, and almost getting run over by a train during his formative years. These experiences deeply affected Kojima, who described these near-death moments as the most intense memories of his childhood. The death of Hideo's father also left his family in a tough financial situation, which put pressure on him to enter a traditional career. Kojima explained, "The common belief in Japan at the time was that fine schools and proper education led to safe and well-paid jobs. This was the Japanese ideal, a regimentation which had consequences for everyone who tried not to follow the mainstream. My dreams of becoming a movie director came into conflict with this unwritten rule of society. It made life harder for me. It made me feel alone and rejected." Bowing to the pressure, Hideo attended a normal university and studied economics, but he refused to give up on his creative dreams. During this period, he hoped to write a novel that could easily be turned into a movie. He submitted short stories to numerous magazines, none of which were picked up. Kojima later concluded that this was because the magazines preferred brief, 100-page short stories, while his own writing frequently topped 400 pages. While in college, Kojima picked up the newly released Famicom, and would play a variety of games during his downtime at school, including shoot-em-ups like Xevious, and text adventures like the Portopia serial murder case. However, none would have the influence on Hideo that Super Mario Bros. Would. Kojima explained to G4, "The game that changed my life. The game of my destiny was Shigeru Miyamoto's Super Mario Bros. Till then, I pretty much had the notion that film and video games were separate entities, but then I realized that even in video games, I could do creative things just like they're done in the movies." Though he was already in his fourth year studying economics, Kojima decided to pursue a career in game design. At the time, the video game industry carried a social stigma in Japan, as many felt it was full of creatives that couldn't make it in filmmaking or writing. Though most of Kojima's friends, family, and professors discouraged him from switching careers, Hideo's mother was supportive and told him he could do whatever he wanted in life. This bolstered Kojima's confidence, and he began looking for work in the games industry. Kojima applied to a company called Konami, though it wasn't because of any specific game that they made. It was simply because Konami was listed on the Japanese Stock Exchange, the only games company to hold that accolade at the time. Not even Nintendo was listed during this period. Kojima saw this as a status symbol, and hoped that working for a publicly traded company would shed a more positive light on his career change. Kojima joined Konami in 1986 as a planner for their MSX team. He was initially disappointed in this assignment, as he wanted to be part of their Famicom team and felt that the MSX's color palette was too limiting. The crew at Konami were very much like Kojima, a group of creative hopefuls that saw video games as a second chance to make their dreams come true. Despite this, Kojima struggled to fit in at first. Planners were practically unheard of on the MSX team, and many of his colleagues considered Kojima dead weight because of his lack of technical skills. Kojima was given an assistant director position on Penguin Adventure, the sequel to 1983's Antarctic Adventure. He worked himself to the bone to prove himself, often refusing to take bathroom breaks and regularly dreaming about the game during his sleep. This hard work caught the attention of one of his superiors, who pulled him off Penguin Adventure and gave him the opportunity to direct his own title. Kojima spent half a year developing a concept called Lost World, but he quickly found his co-workers' lack of confidence wasn't wholly unfounded. He had little knowledge on how to create a game from scratch, how to schedule development, or how to deal with technical issues like memory constraints. After 6 months, little progress had been made and Konami's higher-ups pulled the plug on Kojima's game. This left the young developer devastated, and worsened his co-workers' mocking. Konami gave Kojima one last opportunity, reassigning him to a military-themed game that was struggling to gain traction. Originally, the title had a heavy action focus, but the MSX2's hardware struggled to handle more than a handful of moving sprites at any one time. Hindered by this poor combat, Kojima brainstormed ways to make the gameplay more interesting. He thought back to the film The Great Escape, and how the characters in that story ran away instead of fighting. Deciding that escaping would be a more interesting objective, Kojima redesigned the title from the ground up as a stealth action game. When he told his co-workers, they thought he was crazy. Kojima told The Guardian, "I had such a hard time convincing people. I had so many things going against me at that time. The type of game I wanted to make didn't exist at that time. The odds were stacked against me, and it was very hard to earn the trust of the team." With his team resistant to his ideas, development stalled for months. At one point, Kojima was so frustrated that he considered quitting Konami, but he approached a senior official for advice. This official helped Hideo pitch his ideas to the team, and eventually helped win them over. Despite this, Kojima still came into conflict with his programming staff, who either had no idea how to implement his ideas or outright refused to work on them. The result of this struggle was Kojima's debut title, Metal Gear, which released on the MSX2 on July 17, 1987. Interestingly, though, the box art for the title features traced art of the character Kyle Reese from The Terminator, the cinema-loving Kojima had nothing to do with this. Though Kojima originally wanted to join Konami's Famicom team, working on the MSX turned out to be a blessing in disguise. The computer's advanced hardware and hardcore audience let him design a more intricate game than he would have been able to on the Famicom. Metal Gear was eventually ported to the Famicom without Kojima or his team's consent, and Hideo only played it after picking it out of a bargain bin. He later criticized this version from cutting out content from the MSX version. Regardless, Metal Gear was a surprising critical and commercial success. Critics heaped praise on the title, and it quickly became one of the MSX's best-selling adventure games. The NES version would also go on to sell more than 1 million copies in the United States alone. Now with the hit under his belt, Kojima began work on another new game, this time a story-driven cyberpunk noir called Snatcher. Again, he pulled from his love of film to find inspiration for this new title, borrowing ideas and imagery from sci-fi classics like Blade Runner and Akira. When Kojima pitched the idea of his cyberpunk adventure to Konami's trademark department over the phone, he became frustrated, as they did not understand what cyberpunk meant. Because of the nature of Snatcher's gameplay, Kojima only needed about half as many developers as a regular Famicom development team. Additionally, he recruited character designer Tomiharu Kinoshita to help capture a unique look for Snatcher's cast. Kojima treated Snatcher more like a film or anime, with enough story content to fill out 6 chapters. However, after 1.5 years of development, the team only managed to finish 2 of these chapters before Konami demanded the development wrap so they could release the game. Kojima and his crew desperately tried to squeeze in a final chapter to wrap up its story, but Konami refused to budge on the deadline. Snatcher was released with a cliffhanger ending in late 1988 for both the PC-8801 and the MSX2. Though the title received critical acclaim, it did not sell well, and has since become a cult classic. In 1990, Kojima returned to complete the story in the Japan-exclusive RPG spin-off SD Snatcher for the MSX, but this took a backseat to another project that caught the developer's eye. After Metal Gear's success, Konami released a sequel called Snake's Revenge without Kojima's involvement. This game focused on action, and was developed for a Western audience, never releasing in Japan. On a train, Kojima coincidentally ran into an old coworker who was working on Snake's Revenge. He told Kojima that he didn't feel like Snake's Revenge was a true successor to Metal Gear, and that Hideo should make his own sequel. On his way home, Kojima began brainstorming what his version of a sequel would look like. He credits this chance encounter for his continued involvement with the Metal Gear series. By the next day, Kojima approached his superior with a plan for Metal Gear 2, Solid Snake. And though his superior was enthused, Konami's sales department had second thoughts. Despite great success in the North American market, Metal Gear had sold poorly in Japan. Kojima and his team traveled to Konami's headquarters and spent an entire day arguing with the sales team before the project was finally greenlit. The team obsessively pursued realism for the sequel, gathering as many books, movies, and model guns as possible for research. They even reached out to an ex-Green Beret for advice, and spent days playing war games in the mountains with infrared guns. Some members of the team even started showing up for work in combat fatigues. This dedication paid off, as when Metal Gear 2 Solid Snake was released for the MSX in July of 1990, it remained one of the console's best-selling games for 6 months straight. The title was originally released exclusively in Japan, but was eventually localized for international audiences in 2006. After this, Kojima returned to adventure games, overseeing a remake of Snatcher with full voice acting and a proper ending on the PC Engine Super CD-ROM Squared system. After his difficulties with programmers in the original Metal Gear, Kojima developed his own scripting engine so he could personally control everything in this new game. This tight grip over creative control would become a staple in each of Kojima's titles. The first game to implement this engine would be Kojima's next adventure title, Police Knots. This game was an extension of several themes Kojima explored with Snatcher, but also drew inspiration from the ethics of organ transplantations and brain death injuries, anti-Japanese sentiments from the film Rising Sun, and NASA documentation about the negative effects of space travel on the human body. The story was also inspired by buddy cop dramas like Starsky and Hutch, which were a particular favorite of Kojima's growing up. Harkening back to his love for film, Kojima borrowed many cinematography techniques for Police Knots. He perceived a lack of quality in the production values of other games, and wanted Police Knots to live up to the standards set by movies. Kojima also originally omitted subtitles from Police Knots to evoke a more cinematic feel. However, after receiving a letter from a hearing-impaired fan, he changed his mind and included text. After 4 years of development, Police Knots was released for the PC-9821 in 1994, and was later ported to multiple systems. However, one system in particular captured Kojima's imagination, and would shape his career for decades to come. While finishing up Police Knots, Kojima heard rumors of Sony's new console, the PlayStation. When he finally saw the device, he set out to create a new Metal Gear title, wanting it to be the best game on the PlayStation. Kojima had wanted to make a 3D Metal Gear game for the 3DO, but that console's discontinuation made it an easy decision to jump to the PlayStation's superior hardware. Around this time, Kojima also noticed the artwork of Yoji Shinkawa, a new hire at Konami. Kojima saw Shinkawa's potential and recruited him to help define Metal Gear Solid's art direction and character designs. The decision paid off, as Shinkawa's art became an integral part of the Metal Gear brand. Kojima felt that Metal Gear Solid needed to be as believable as possible, and turned to California's Hunting Beach SWAT department to learn as much as he could about modern tactics. He even personally bashed down doors with battering rams and handled machine guns for research. Much of the stealth gameplay that defined the first Metal Gear was updated for the new 3D environment, and it's possible for players to complete the game without killing any character except its main bosses. This gameplay was massively influential for the industry, and would be copied by countless titles afterwards. Kojima later said, "If the player isn't tricked into believing that the world is real, then there is no point in making the game. If you can captivate the player without having to trick them, then the game is worthwhile. That is the most tiring task. A lot of adjustments had to be made, down to the tiniest detail like individual desks." Further fulfilling Kojima's desire to bring games closer to movies, Metal Gear Solid featured an intro and opening credits sequence that resembled a film far more than other video games. Metal Gear Solid was released in September of 1998 to both critical and commercial success. Several publications praised its storytelling and gameplay, crediting the game for popularizing the stealth genre. Both IGN and users on the official PlayStation blog ranked Metal Gear Solid the best game on the PlayStation, and was also featured in the Smithsonian American Art Museum's exhibition on the art of video games in 2012. Worldwide, Metal Gear Solid has sold more than 6 million copies, a figure that surprised Kojima. He explained, "We were just making the game that we wanted to play. I don't think I had any expectations that it was going to be a big game. So when I heard that it was selling well in America, it didn't feel real. Ecstatic with the game's performance, Konami quickly commissioned a sequel that would utilize the more powerful hardware of the PlayStation 2. Kojima immediately began to work on the sequel, completing its design document in 1999 before moving into full development. Given the success of Metal Gear Solid, Kojima's team was given a budget of over $10 million for this new title, which Kojima put to good use by furthering its cinematic elements. The sequel featured several hours worth of cutscenes, incorporated motion capture technology, and touted a score co-composed by Hollywood veteran Cary Gregson-Williams. It also had a twist worthy of a big-budget blockbuster. Despite the controversial twist, Metal Gear Solid 2's Sons of Liberty was again a critical and commercial hit, proving that Kojima's success with Metal Gear Solid on the PlayStation 1 wasn't a fluke. Kojima rocketed to superstardom in the games industry, becoming a well-known name amongst journalists and consumers. During the 2000s, he continued producing a variety of titles, including multiple Metal Gear spin-offs, remakes, and re-releases, two titles in the mecha anime-inspired Zone of the Enders franchise, two action RPGs in the Boktai series, and the Castlevania reboot Lords of Shadow. In 2004, Kojima returned to Metal Gear with the intention of creating a prequel set in a completely different jungle environment. This title drew more from Cold War political fiction and the spy thriller franchise James Bond. Metal Gear Solid 3 Snake Eater was released in November of 2004 for the PlayStation 2, and is considered one of the greatest games of all time. Though Kojima intended for Snake Eater to be the conclusion of the franchise, fan demand meant that a new installment went into development right away. Kojima originally declined the director's chair, but signed on as co-director alongside Shuya Murata after intense negative feedback from fans. This new title would also be the most cinematic game Kojima made to date, with several hours worth of cutscenes. In fact, the title holds the record for longest single cutscene in history, locking in at 27 minutes. Metal Gear Solid 4 Guns of the Patriots was released on June 12, 2008 to universal acclaim, and has since sold over 6 million copies. Kojima's personal life and relationships also impacted his professional career during this time. He often played games with his son, including Super Smash Bros., though his son questioned why none of Kojima's characters were playable. When Kojima heard that his friend Masahiro Sakurai was developing a sequel to Smash Bros., he practically begged Sakurai to include Snake in the roster. Unfortunately, this was infeasible, as Sakurai was already too far into Melee's unusually short development cycle. However, Snake was later included as the first third-party character in the franchise with Super Smash Bros. Brawl. Kojima's mother also kept up with their son's games, though it would sometimes take her over a year to beat any one of them. When she finally beat Metal Gear Solid 3, she called Hideo and simply said, "It is finished." With more than two decades of success to his name, Kojima was promoted to Vice President and Corporate Officer of Konami Digital Entertainment in 2011. This new role allowed him to further spread his influence and experiment with viral marketing. Kojima ordered the creation of a new game engine dubbed the Fox Engine, which he claimed could be used to develop anything from first-person shooters to third-person adventure games. In August of 2012, Kojima showed off the Fox Engine with a demo titled Metal Gear Solid Ground Zeroes, a prologue for Metal Gear Solid 5. In December of that year, an unknown developer named Moby Dick Studio showed off an impressive in-game trailer for The Phantom Pain, directed by a man named Joachim Mogren. Many commentators noted the visual resemblance of The Phantom Pain to Ground Zeroes, and that Joachim was an anagram for Kojima, believing this to be an elaborate teaser for a new Metal Gear. Metal Gear Solid 5, The Phantom Pain was revealed in March of 2013, and was later released in September of 2015, with a Hideo Kojima game proudly stamped above the logo. Once again, the title received universal acclaim and shipped more than 6 million copies as of December 2016. Kojima's love for multimedia again seeped into Metal Gear Solid 5, with actor Kiefer Sutherland replacing longtime voice actor David Hayter as Snake. Though the game had a budget of more than $80 million, a great deal of its content was cut, including several missions from later in the game and a more elaborate ending. Though there has been no official explanation, it is believed these cuts were due to undisclosed friction between Kojima and Konami's higher-ups. For years before the release of Metal Gear Solid 5, Kojima stated that he'd wanted to work on a horror game, and in particular to reboot the Silent Hill franchise. In August of 2014, a first-person horror game called PT was released on the PlayStation Store. The game, which featured a looping hallway and cryptic story, quickly caught the attention of internet content creators who wanted to solve its mystery. Despite its creators intending for PT to take over a week to complete, players cracked it within just a few hours of release, revealing it to be a playable teaser for a new Silent Hill game starring Norman Reedus from Kojima and film director Guillermo del Toro. The reveal came as a surprise, but nonetheless, Silent Hills quickly became an anticipated title. However, things were not well behind the scenes at Konami. On March 3, 2015, IGN Italia posted an interview with Kojima where he confirmed that Metal Gear Solid 5 would be his final title in the franchise, and that he considered the series complete even if it continued without him. The very same day, Konami announced that they were restructuring their company, and Kojima's name was nowhere to be seen on the list of personnel changes on their website. Within a couple weeks, Konami scrubbed the Kojima Productions logo and the tagline, a Hideo Kojima game, from the Metal Gear website, promotional materials, and even Metal Gear Solid 5's box art. Though there had been no official word from either party, GameSpot reported that there had been a falling out between Kojima and executives at Konami due to power struggles. This resulted in the publisher restricting access to basic corporate resources at Kojima Productions, and demoting most of Kojima's developers to contractors instead of employees. Though there was never any official comment on it, the falling out had become the subject of public scrutiny. In late April of 2015, Konami confirmed that Silent Hills had indeed been cancelled, and pulled PT from the PlayStation Store. They even disallowed users from re-downloading the title if it were no longer on their console. On October 9, 2015, Kojima left the Tokyo office of Kojima Productions, or Number 8 Production Department as Konami had renamed it, for the final time following a going-away party thrown in his honor. Despite photographic proof, Konami feigned ignorance for the reason for this party, asserting that Kojima wasn't leaving the company but rather taking a long vacation. The Los Angeles branch of Kojima Productions, since renamed Konami Los Angeles, was closed the following month. During the 2015 Game Awards, after Metal Gear Solid V won Best Score and Best Action-Adventure Game, host Jeff Keighley stated that Konami had barred Kojima from attending the show to accept the awards. This news was met with audible boos from the crowd. Finally, on December 15, 2015, Kojima's departure from Konami was made official, though neither Kojima nor Konami ever detailed the official reasons as to why. Still, Kojima took this in stride instead of lashing out at Konami, taking to Twitter to say, "Today marks a new start for me. I'm committed to be involved in creative activities for as long as I live. Look forward to what's coming next." On December 16, 2015, just one day after officially leaving Konami, Kojima founded a newly independent Kojima Productions. Shortly afterwards, a partnership between Kojima Productions and Sony Computer Entertainment was announced, with Kojima to direct a new AAA title. At E3 2016, Kojima dramatically took the stage at Sony's press conference to thunderous applause, stating,
"Hello everyone, I'm back!"
His game was revealed to be Death Stranding, with both Reedus and Del Toro returning from Silent Hills, and several other Hollywood stars later being attached to the game. Death Stranding has proved to be somewhat mysterious, with Kojima stating he hopes the game and a potential sequel would establish a new genre. Death Stranding is set to be released on November 8, 2019. Though the chapter of Hideo Kojima's career at Konami has come to a close, a brand new one is opening up for the developer. From his unique cinematic approach to game development and design, to his use of social media to discuss his love of film with fans, Kojima has cemented his place in multimedia history, an impressive feat for someone whose start in gaming was met with ridicule. Very few developers can say they deserve to label their games with their name, but you know a Hideo Kojima game when you play one. Did you also know the movie studio behind Escape from New York wanted to sue Kojima and Konami for copyright infringement over Solid Snake? Or that Masahiro Sakurai worked so hard on Smash Brothers that he had to be hospitalized? For more facts, check out our videos on Metal Gear Solid and Masahiro Sakurai.